Voice of the Sea. Learning from experts across the ocean.
Welcome to Voice of the Sea. In this episode, we're at the Palau Mariculture Demonstration Center. Center manager John Ngirailld shows us how they grow giant clams and explains how the center helps Palauans start their own clam farms free of charge. Through these programs, the center has given away millions of seedlings, helping Palauans establish small-scale commercial aquaculture programs and helping to re-establish giant clam populations in the wild, which are important for cultural, ecological, and economic reasons.
Hi, John. Hi. Thank you so much for having me here at the Palau Mariculture Demonstration Center. That means that you demonstrate your mariculture practices. Right. It's a place where people can come learn about how to culture and grow different marine organisms or just the giant clam.
Oh, we're just doing the giant clam.
So mariculture means culture of marine organisms.
Yeah, and we're also doing trochus. But we're just starting on the early stage.
What's a trochus?
Trochus.
So this is a trochus?
Yes, that's a trochus.
And you guys are starting to culture these too?
Yes, we started to culture. We did this before and kind of stuff, and now they say, okay, just do it again. So we start to bring it up again.
And what do you use them for?
Okay, we grow it. I mean, we do spawning, we just throw it on in the rifts. They will eventually grow to a certain size, like 3 inches up.
Uh-huh.
That's a good size to harvest.
Uh-huh.
Then a lot of Japanese guys comes down and buys the shells.
Oh, they're not for eating.
Not for eating. They buy the shells. They got tons of shells, and they take it and bring it home. Mm-hmm. And they make buttons, paints, you know, yearly. Yearly. So during summertime, this is the only open season for. Yeah. And the meat is good. They don't need the meat, so we take the meat. We just give them the shell.
That sounds good.
Yeah.
So this is your office here?
This is our office. This is our manager's office here. This is our crew, our office here, everybody. And then we come here, we brief it every morning. Then we go out and do our work.
Let's go take a look at your work then.
Right. So this is our shop where we put our staff. This is a cage.
Uh-huh.
Well, we put clam here. You know, we put him in the deeper water that we're using because we got a lot of predators. So uh-huh. We use this mesh to protect it.
This would go out into the open water.
The open
then.
Water.
Very
and
cool.
And this is how it looks, but it has to be in the deep water. So, yeah, this is our. Oh, this is the bigger tank, which is for a. Where we collect eggs and put them in.
Uh-huh.
And then once they grow to be like, you know, about 2 to 3 centimeters, then we just transfer all these tanks.
And then they grow out in these tanks?
Yeah, they grow out in these tanks. Until up to be like they're about 1 year to 2 years old. And then we'll give it to the farmers.
Oh, and then they put it in the pen like we just
yeah,
saw?
Yeah, we put them in the pen in their farm and they grow it and do whatever they want.
How big do they need to get before you would harvest them?
They can get to be like a full, 1 foot. That's and you can harvest them for eating consumption.
Uh-huh.
But for aquarium tray, it has to be smaller because you got to give to the aquarium like this size over here.
So people could buy this size for the aquarium.
Yeah. So yeah.
They're so.
So these are crocias. Because we got seven different species of clam.
Oh, really?
Yes, we do.
And they're all in the genus Tridacna?
Yeah, they're all in genus Tridacna. Except two. Like, yeah, two of them is hippopus. See, like those one over there.
Ah, the more
yeah,
wavy shells.
They're not in the genus Tridacna. Yeah, these are hippopus.
How can you tell the difference between the Tridacna species?
Oh, yeah, I've been doing this too long. I can tell this. Especially Croceas and Maximus. See, you got a Maximus there, but I can't tell which one is a Maximus and Crocea.
Well, okay, I'm not as smart as you, so tell me how you know
okay.
The difference.
See, the Croceas don't have that
it's more like rounding. Uh-huh. You know, like you can tell the shape outside. It's usually like kind of smoothy. And then we got a Maxima, which is this one. See this red, greenish, brownish, yeah?
Oh, and it has more like ruffles on it.
And also, it's a little bigger. They're usually just a little bigger than crochets.
I see. And they have such beautiful colors. Where do they get their colors from?
You know, these pieces of crochets and Maximus, they have this algae. It's called zooxanthellae algae.
The zooxanthellae?
Yeah. And it's in the genes of these two species. Because usually these two species have the brightest color of them all.
I see.
So, you know, usually that's how we tell. Also the Derasus, which is, is that one over there? But I'll show you that later.
Okay.
Okay, this is a 2-year-old Gigas.
Gigas, Tridacna Gigas.
Tridacna, this will become the giant, the biggest of them all. The cutest, this piece is right here.
Now, some people say that those really big giant clams could actually swallow you up.
That's not true.
How come?
You know, because the bigger they get, the muscle in there gets bigger.
Uh-huh.
So but they can't close because the muscle is too thick to close the mouth. So that thing, actually when it's big and you can stick your hand in there, it'll go that far and that's it. They cannot go all the way, except the small ones. They go all the way.
Could this one close up?
No. So actually you can see it. I can put my hand in there. See, it's kind of close also, but not all the way. That's how far it can go.
Can I touch him?
Yeah.
Oh!
It won't go all the way.
But when it closes, a bunch of water.
Yeah. You know, it's like a pressure is pouring out.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Okay, this guy here. This guy's doing spawning. See that from here? It's milky. It's milky.
Oh, yeah.
That's usually a sperm.
How do they know they're supposed to spawn?
Okay. out in the wild, the clam kids, they can spawn twice. Like the full moon and the first moon.
Okay.
You know, it's a calendar cycle. That's out in the wild. But up here, we got this new technique. Like, you know, the expert came and told us we can cut one, get the gonad, put in a syringe shot, then you shot it through this hole here.
Uh-huh.
Then you wait for 30 minutes and then the sperm starts squirting on the other side. Like this one right now.
So you cheat by taking the gonad of one and you squirt it into the other clam and then it sends out the sperm.
Yeah, you know, it sends out the sperm.
And then what do you do?
Then you collect some sperm,
uh-huh.
About 4 to 5 cups, put them in a container, and then we wait for the egg because the eggs will follow the sperm.
I see.
And then they start squirting eggs, and that's when you get it, you rush it, put them in the container. So when it squirts, you know, you can keep all the eggs in the container. So, like this one here, I think it's sperm, then maybe 1 hour later, then.
Did the eggs look different?
It looks different. Once they come out, if you're lucky, they come out and you're still here, I can show you.
Okay.
Yeah. The tiny, like salt, you know, tiny, you know, millions and millions of eggs.
And once the eggs and the sperms come together, they're fertilized. What do you do then?
Then we take that egg, it's already fertilized, and put them in a bigger tank. Then 2 days to 3 days, you feed that egg.
What do you feed it?
Okay. Then we have to cut another one, or the same clam that...
Same species.
Yeah, same species. Then you cut it, and then you go to the mantle, and you scrape it, and you get the zooxanthellae.
You feed them the zooxanthellae?
You filter that, and then you feed it. And once they eat it,
they can photosynthesize.
Right, there you go.
Very cool.
Yeah. That's and then they start to settle.
Do you have any special substrate or bottom that they need to settle onto?
Not really. It's just a tank right there, and they just drop in and start from there. You know, see that? You just saw that? You just skirted. These are Maximus, though. These are Maximus.
They're so cool.
Yeah. Yeah, let's go there. I'll show you the bigger ones. So most of these are just 1 to 3 years old, and then from here to the farmers. So this is a container where we're spawning. Like this guy over here. We just put it because he was squirting sperm.
Uh-huh.
So you put him there and let it squirt the sperm. That way you collect the sperm. And then you put them in the other window. When you collect egg, you just put it, mix it together.
Uh-huh.
You know? We don't want to overdo the sperm because it kills the eggs.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yes. 2 months sperm will kill the egg. So, like I said, 4 to 5 cups. Good enough for the entire eggs. So these are Derasa species right here.
Oh, what species is this?
Derasa.
Derasa?
Yeah.
And what is different about them?
You know, it's different species from Maximus and Croziers and Gigas and Squamoses. Because, you know, this is the big, as they would go. They can't grow any bigger than this now.
This is their maximum size?
Yes, this is their maximum size.
And
these
so
are our broodstocks.
These are your broodstocks where you collect the eggs and the sperm?
Yeah.
It's so amazing to me how each one has its individual colors.
Yeah, I know.
Do you have a favorite kind?
Yeah, the blue ones. I mean, it's really... Okay, hold on. Oh, maybe this one here? Oh yeah, this one's camouflage. You go to the other side, they turn greenish, and then you come to this, it's red, and they turn blue.
Oh.
You go try that.
Oh my gosh,
yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
And then tell me about the holes that they have.
The what? The holes.
Oh, the holes.
Okay. The bigger one, that's where we squirt where you squirt the gonad, that's where it's like their mouth. That's where they filter all their food.
That's their mouth.
Yeah. And the other hole on the other side, that's where the voice stay. And when they do spawning, sperm and egg comes out on that side.
So
the smaller one.
The bigger hole that's kind of looks like this, that's their mouth?
Yep.
And then they suck in
water? Right, everything.
And then the round one, that's where they shoot out
the eggs? Yeah, that's where they shoot out the eggs. Everything go in, go out the outside.
I know they photosynthesize with the zooxanthellae. Do they also filter things out of the water?
Yep. Yes, they do.
And about how much would one of these weigh?
Weight?
Yeah.
Oh, that would be about like 30 pounds.
Oh my gosh.
Yes. They're kind of heavy though. There they are.
How much meat inside of
there? Oh, 1 meal can be enough for like 3 to 4 people.
What does it taste like?
Well, it's like octopus. If you eat octopus,
like
seafood.
Octopus.
Yeah, shrimp. You know,
it's delicious.
Yeah, it's really delicious. You gotta try it one time. So this is where we put our broodstocks. Out here. See the giant one over here. Gigas, the giant one. See the white one in the middle?
Oh yeah.
That's about 30 years old.
And you just put it out here, no one comes and takes it?
Yeah. We got the marine surveillance over there. Yeah, it's protected.
How big is that one?
Well, that's about like 30 years old. Yeah.
And how did you start working with the clams?
How did I start working with the clams? I've been working here for about 14 years now. Yeah.
What made you come start working here?
I was really interested working in the water. I didn't know I was going to do the clam. But anything to do in the water, I was interested in that.
Did you know about giant clams before you came to work here?
Yeah, I knew, but I didn't know much about all the species and how they do spawning and the differences of the shapes and colors. Yeah.
What is your favorite thing about working with the clams?
My favorite working with the clams is, spawn them, give it to the farmers, so they won't go out and get the ones from the wild and do that, because that's not right. Get the cultured ones, that way you can reuse it and leave the ones in the wild. I hope it works, and people are learning to do that, so, yeah.
What is the hardest part of your job?
The hardest part of my job? It's really hot out here. Yeah, it's really hot out here. You do a lot of labor cleaning the tanks. Once we empty the tanks, you gotta clean it for the next, spawning time. So we gotta make sure to clean it. Oh yeah, and we also, every other week, we kind of drain it and flush and get all the algae and the sluts, flush it out and fill it up again. And then we put some rabbit fish in here too, because they eat algae.
Uh-huh.
They help us clean those algae, so it's pretty cool.
That is pretty cool.
Yeah.
You guys, I understand, have won some awards here for your ability to culture the giant clams, the Chiridacna. So many people come and they learn from you and your techniques?
Yes. Yes, we do. During summertime, students from various high schools come over. We give them a lecture and we work together, like transferring eggs during the spawning time, go out to the farms and educating the farmers, things like that.
Uh-huh. And so you're maybe training the next generation?
Yeah, I'm training the next generation to make them understand. So that way, they can talk about it with their friends and, hopefully in the next generation all the way, till I'm gone.
What does that mean?
Till I'm gone, till my generations are gone, and then they're aware, they already know the conservation, things like that. That way, that way we won't lose it, or you still got a lot of problems about poachers, local poachers, foreign poachers. So yeah. Clam is really cool. If you just bring it out there and leave it, and that's all it takes. You just leave it, and then it'll take care of itself.
That is very cool.
Yeah. See this tray here?
Mm-hmm.
This is where we plant the baby clams.
We
put him in that cage. Santos, Soares, Michel Dagua. And then we put a clam in here, and then we put him in that cage.
When they're like this big?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, like this big right here. If this is like the one here. And then you can put like 10 here, 10 on each row, so you got like 50 or 60 in each tray. Just put them in that cage. Yeah. Especially the maximum enclosures, because they got food. The food get attached to the concrete. But
and some of the other ones don't have that foot?
Yeah, they don't have that foot.
So they can just roll around?
Yeah, but once they get bigger, they kind of get heavier, so we can,
I see.
Well, most of the farmers, they farm right next to these walls of, this rock island. That way, when the wind is stronger from the west or the east, you don't have the pressure of the water that comes down because you got this wall that black thing, so it's cool.
The clams like to be kind of in calm water.
Yeah, calm water, especially when you have a farm.
Oh, because there's a lot of them next to each other. Yeah. So they like calm water, clear water, and lots of sun.
Yeah. And also where the current is, because they need all that food from the current. Yeah.
Where else do you guys send any of your baby clams besides in Palau?
Yeah, we send some to Yap. And some to Saipan, we did Kosrae.
Kosrae.
Yeah, but not Pian. And they did that like, back in the 90s, they did a lot of sending it out to the other Pacific Islands. You know, they have some species, but not as similar species we have. So we give them the one they don't have. So they took a lot of Derasas. Yeah, and some hippopus.
And all the species that you guys culture here are native to Palau?
Yeah, they're all native to Palau. Except like, I think there's two. I mean, all together, I think there are 9 species all over. But we don't have the other two, like the Tivora from the Tonga and Fiji. Yeah, I've seen the picture, it's kind of, ugly thing to do. And the rose water.
Oh.
Sort of like Maxima. I've seen the pictures, really similar to Maxima. But, yeah, those are the two that we don't have, but it's all right.
Yeah. You're happy with the ones you have?
Yeah, I'm happy with the ones we have.
Very cool. Yeah. I know that people eat the clams, but what else are they used for besides food?
Oh, besides food? There are a lot of people that live right next to water. They just plant it, like you plant your flower, you know, around the house, you know, so you go out there and it's just beautiful down there. There's another house over there that, you know, it's got a waterway through the front lawn. So you go there, there's clams on the front lawn.
And then people put them in their aquarium?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, people put them in the aquarium. But we don't have as much as aquarium out here, like they do in the outside. So we got a lot of demand from outside. Yes, we do. We got a lot of demand from outside. Good business.
So you guys will sell the medium-sized ones to the aquarium trade, and then they ship them, and people like in the mainland United States can have a clam in their aquarium.
They have a clam. Or they just buy as much as they want. They go out and they resell it for, you know, you got to have a partner.
And what about those big shells? What do people do with those if they buy the big shell?
Big shells. Big shells is good for, you know, for decorations around the house. And some, like the giant shells, some people make sinks out of it.
Oh, wow.
Drill a hole, put the faucet in, you know, on top of it. It's a cool shell. But you got to grind the edge because it's kind of sharp. You don't want to get cut.
Maybe you can show me some of the shells that you guys
have? Yeah, sure. See, this is a shell of a Derasa. This is about 15 years old. One side of that, it's kind of heavy. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It's heavy.
Oh,
so these are gift shelf, It's hot. The condition is broken down. Yeah. So this is see this? This is a squamosa shell.
Squamosa.
It's different from the Derasa, the Maximus. You see, it's kind of got this, it's like a scale out here.
These are two different species?
No, these are the same species.
The same. This one is just closer together.
Yeah.
Older maybe?
Yeah, a little older.
Oh, I see. You have the different species.
Yeah. Well, these are pictures for the different species. So you want to take a look? All these red dots? These are all the farm we do.
Oh, my.
Yeah. And this is how the farm looks like in one of them farm. And this is how they look underwater when we do put tray, put gravel, put the, you know, 3 years old clam in there, put them, put thousands of it, let them take care of it. And we go out and monitor them.
Uh-huh.
Just to make sure the program keeps going good. Yeah, I was diving here the, like about 3 years ago, and I found this. I think it's a helmet from the Japanese doing a Japanese occupation.
Oh.
And all these corals is
grew on top of the helmet.
Look at that! Yeah.
No way.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Oh, these are hippopotamus.
Oh, the ones that we saw outside.
Yeah.
They're quite different looking.
Yep. The hippopotamus shell. This is how it looks like when you know, we put chlorine, and then after that we dip it in the muriatic acid, and it adds all these white spots and rocks, and then it gives you this natural color.
Oh. So underneath this is this pattern.
Is that one. That's right.
That's very pretty. And you guys, this is your museum, or you sell the shells?
Yes, we sell it.
I had no idea you guys had so many.
Yeah, farms. We got more than 50 farms right now.
And are those partly funded by the Palau government?
They got money for that program. But we just give it to the farmers. Everything is free for the farmers, free of charge.
Wow.
Whoever wants the farm, just come here, fill out the form, get your materials, we bring the materials to the water, start building the farm.
Do you have a farm?
See that? It's not fair, because my boss said, none of you guys can do a farm. I said, why not? Because you work here. That's not fair. You know?
I agree. Pick
these guys, man, give them the farm. Give me millions of clam and I don't have anything. So, yeah, I guess when I'm done here or retired, I'll
start a
farm. Do my farm. Yeah. This is about like 7 years ago.
Wow, that is super cool.
That is 7 years ago.
And you guys are planting?
Yeah, we're planting.
Out in a farm.
Out in the farm. So we're all here. So this used to be my boss. And yeah, but he's gone now. He's got moved to Coral Reef Center.
Uh-huh.
But we all see her. Yeah.
And what's going on up here?
Oh yeah, this is cleaning, you know, because the algae.
Uh-huh.
So when the baby is like tiny, you know, baby clams like that, they get stuck to the algae. So you kind of come and then separate the clam from the algae. Then you throw the algae away and then clean them and put it back in. Something like that again.
And you guys did a training course?
Yeah, I did. That was in Korea. That's me in Percy. That's me and Percy at the back on top. We went to Korea for a training course. Yeah, so I've been out in Japan, Korea, Taiwan. Yeah, good experience. Fun too.
The University of Hawaii Sea Grant College Program. Helping coastal communities of Hawaii and the Pacific through research, education, and outreach. Serving the community from elementary to graduate students. Hawaii Sea Grant.
Exploring Our Fluid Earth is the dynamic curriculum developed by the University of Hawaii's Curriculum Research and Development Group. The award-winning Fluid Earth and Living Ocean textbooks are now interactive and online. New activities, updated content, and a teacher community. Exploring Our Fluid Earth is now freely available. Find out more at exploringourfluidearth.org.
Turn your love of the ocean into a lifelong career. Join NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, as we unlock the secrets in the deep oceans, track rapidly moving storms, model climate trends, protect and preserve our marine resources, and so much more. It's all in a day's work at NOAA. Find a career that makes a world of difference, enriching life through science, service, and stewardship. NOAA.
The Curriculum Research and Development Group in the College of Education at the University of Hawaii at Manoa. CRDG's training roots go back over 40 years. Through professional development programs, curriculum workshops, research on teaching methodology, individualized school and district training, and so much more. The Curriculum Research and Development Group, Improving Schools, Improving Education. CRDG.
Healthy oceans are critical to our cultural, economic, and environmental sustainability in Hawaii. The ocean serves as a source of water, food, medicine, jobs, transportation, recreation, and energy. It controls climate and weather. Kosi Island Earth aims to share this ocean awareness by partnering with local scientists and educators to engage communities and schools in active science learning for an ocean-literate population. Kosi Island Earth is working to establish new avenues for connecting research scientists with educators and communities. Kosi Island Earth is enhancing the science and ocean literacy of our island residents and visitors. Kosi Island Earth is connecting scientific research, traditional knowledge, and ocean policy. Kosi Island Earth, bringing together university, government, research, and community partners to improve science education and ocean stewardship in Hawaii.